Over the last 10 years, Centum has transformed even in terms of people. It moved from a company of 13 people to today's 177 people directly working for Centum, without mentioning the other associated companies. During that period, Centum has also become an employer of choice, winning some notable awards. Just to mention them, in 2018, recently they were mentioned as the top, as one of the top 100 Africa employer of choice by Careers in Africa. In 2015, they were also awarded Africa's Financial Services Employer of Choice. Today, we are privileged to speak to James Moria, who will be giving us more insight into how it all happened. My name is Pius Mushiru Mugo, the Managing Director of Nabo Capital, and you're watching Invest in Africa. James Moria, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Yeah, you know, I was just doing my homework before I came here, and I saw a very interesting statement you said a couple of years ago. The only limitation for an organization is the quality of human capital within it. James Moria, just give us insight. How has your leadership journey been, and how has it evolved?
Yeah, my leadership journey has been interesting, and it has changed over time.
Yeah.
So 10 years ago, was a hands-on doer. So that was where we started, and then moved on to simultaneously sort of developing people, then progressively began doing more through people as we developed the leadership team, and ultimately to what it is now, where you are a leader of other leaders and where you've developed a cadre of leadership, and they in turn are developing the leaders within their respective businesses. Mm. So the leadership style 10 years ago and the leadership style today is totally different as the organization has evolved.
So James, why all these changes? Maybe you can give us more insight. What was triggering the change in your leadership style?
When I took over as CEO, the team was very small. We only 13 people.
Yeah.
And of those 13, a good number of them were in support.
Yeah.
So the core team, the core investment team, was very small.
Yes.
And so you have to work with that team.
Yes.
So it therefore meant that at that time, I was the implementer. So you're implementing, you are very hands-on, if you remember everything that was done, from a board paper to anything,
yes.
You are sort of in the middle of it,
yes.
Doing it with others. Mm. Yeah? But then you see, for you to be effective, first you must do, so that others can see you doing.
Yeah.
Then you must do with them,
so
that then they can learn from example. Then they do as you watch. And you remember at some point I moved from doing now to doing reviewing.
Yes.
We've done together, now you are sort of reviewing. Then now people go off and do on their own, which is something that has happened for some time.
Yeah.
And then ultimately now they start teaching others.
Yeah.
So we've moved through that phase. So it's just a function of time. It's a function of growth. And actually, if I did not change, the company would have stagnated, because there's only so many hours in a day you have.
Yeah.
And if you must insist that everything you must do,
yeah,
or everything you must do and review,
yeah,
then you become the bottleneck.
Yeah.
And therefore you must empower other leaders,
yeah,
and trust that they can do and teach others,
yeah,
without you being present.
Yeah.
That's the only way you can expand the organization,
yeah,
so that you're no longer the bottleneck,
yeah,
in the organization. So it's been a journey of growth, a journey of letting go, but it is what was necessary for the business to go onto its next growth phase.
Yeah,
yeah.
One of the things that you're extremely passionate about is the graduate trainee. I don't know whether it's because you rose from an intern,
yeah.
Maybe you can give us more insight. What has been your vision around the graduate trainee program?
I think First, the graduate trainee program is a program we came up with where we took a view that the constraint we had in our business was leadership.
Mm.
And we need to develop leadership, but also leadership that we are aligned culturally.
Mm.
So what had proven difficult for us was the mid-level hires we were bringing into the company were either not staying long enough or were not culturally aligned.
Yeah.
And therefore, we took a view that it would make sense for us to recruit talented individuals straight from university, give them, develop them, but also give them challenging assignments and grow our own leadership pipeline from within the business.
Yeah.
And I guess part of the reason I was passionate about it is that that was the route I had taken to join the organization.
Yeah.
And so I am here because somebody gave me a chance, and the idea was, how else do we give other people a chance? Because most of the job ads you see, they ask for experience.
Yeah.
What about that person who is experienced, who is passionate, but who has no experience? Who is going to give them the opportunity?
Yeah.
And so we began this program about 6 years ago.
Yeah.
And today, 60%, more than 60% of the staff of this organization, especially on the professional side of the business, have come in through the graduate program. We've ended up with excellent retention. So all the things we thought were going to be possible have become possible.
Yeah.
Many businesses, the level just below the managing directors of business, you now have, including your business in Nabo, some of the people in Nabo, in Bariam, maybe the bulk of your senior leadership team has come in through this particular program. So it has worked because you then have individuals who understand the culture and they have bought into it and it's their own. It's not an alien culture, because that culture will eat strategy for lunch.
Yeah.
So if you can influence culture from the ground up, then you have an opportunity to build a sustainable organization. So for these individuals, they have worked nowhere else but Centum. So they only know this one style of working. And we've been fortunate from a retention point of view. Very few of them have left to join other organizations. In fact, the majority who have left to go and advance their studies, which is something I really encourage.
Yeah.
And say, if you want to go out, go and advance your studies and come back, we'll try very hard to place you within the organization. Because I'm a great believer in personal growth.
Yeah.
And if you're here and you're growing, and we've had people leaving, going for their masters, and coming back and rejoining the organization who've been through that graduate program.
Yeah.
So our successors in this business and in this company, and even some of the people today who are leading this, some of our companies have come up through the program. I see them coming from that pool and the others that you're graduating. In fact, my only sort of regret is that the business has not grown fast enough for us to absorb more, because the constraint today is the size of the business, and really the idea is not just to keep a job but to give them meaningful experience across the business. But for that you need the business to grow fast enough so that you can absorb more of them and give them a meaningful challenge.
You spoke about culture, which is what makes Centum stand out. How would you describe the Centum culture?
I think Centum culture is a what I would call a can-do culture. It's a venturing culture. It's a risk-taking culture to a large extent, and it's very well captured in our golden rules, which I think you recall. You were there that day when we sat. I think it was in 2011 or 2010. And we said, there'll be more people soon in this organization than the people were in it. What will those people say was special about the team they found? Because it's easy to get your culture diluted by the newcomers. And what was interesting for me is that when we wrote it down, it took us 30 minutes to come up with those golden rules. And that shows how well aligned we were. We could all agree this is who we are. And there was not much debate. But what is also interesting is that we've not changed anything, not even a word, in the last 6-7 years. And yes, there are people who have joined us, especially senior level hires, who've challenged various elements of the culture, but it's a culture that has stood still. So what we need to defend is that culture, because that is what has made us successful. And even at that time we asked, what has made us successful, what has been unique.
Yeah.
And we've defended our culture.
Yeah.
And that's why today we had all those, the golden rules printed and put everywhere.
Yeah.
So that we can always reference back who are we.
Yeah.
Because sometimes it is, especially when you have challenges,
yeah,
it is easy to forget who you are.
Yeah.
And you start venturing off, meandering off the course.
Yes.
And saying, maybe if we were this,
would
be successful. But you're losing your identity.
Yes.
So it's, I think, having that identity, constantly referencing back to it, and not forgetting yourself, both in the challenging times, but also in the good times. When you have success, it's also, again, easy to forget who you are, and you become something different from what you what you began with.
You know, speaking about golden rules, what it would be interesting to know, what are your two favorable golden rules?
For me, one is that we are positive.
Yes.
You know, that belief that that you're going to succeed is for me, it's everything.
Yeah.
The second one I like is that we do not do tomorrow what we should have done yesterday.
Yeah.
That sense of urgency,
yes,
that whatever you're doing, do it quickly.
Yeah.
Then the third one is the, I think I would like to add two more.
Yeah.
The, that one is we get it done.
Yeah.
Above all, when all the stories are said, what have you done?
Yes.
Tangibly, get it done. And the final one I think we have at the bottom there is integrity, integrity, integrity.
Yeah.
And I think that has served as well.
Yeah.
We've had many, many transactions, many, many partners, and we've never had an issue with any of our partners over the last 10 years.
Yeah.
I think that is who we are.
Yeah.
It's we try to deal with all our partners with integrity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So James, I'm reminded of a conversation I was having with someone else. This was an international recruiting firm. So they had reached out to me and I didn't even wait for them to say much. I said no.
Yeah.
And they tell me, pause, I want to ask you a question. And they asked me, why is it that I have spoken to all the senior leadership in Centum and they've all told me no.
Yeah.
And I want to turn over that question to you because it, I think it does reflect on your leadership and the influence that you've had on your people and you've been able to keep your good people with you regardless. What has been your secret sauce around people?
I think it's also everything is in our golden rules. You know, one of them, it's our business.
Yeah.
We create value and we share the value. Yeah. So it's not a James Moria story.
Mm.
It's a story of everybody and everybody seeing this as their business.
Yes.
So for Pius, you and your team, it's your business.
Yes.
And when people have that sense of ownership, that they're not doing this for so and so, I actually am personally invested in the business and I can make a difference. I think that sort of recruitment is what has made a difference. So those people who have been invested in that, they have tended to stay for a very long time because somebody is asking you to leave your business.
Yes.
To go and be part of their business.
Yes.
So many people here see this as their business and the passion with which they do their work. You know, when you call somebody on a Sunday, and I send a message, you know, I saw this, I send them a photo of something I saw that is relevant to their business, and you see them replying. They're not working like employees.
Mm-mm.
They have an ownership mindset.
Mm.
And so the idea is to, one, seek out people who can have that ownership mindset, and then empower them so that they are real owners. So the good things that happen in their business, the bad things that happen, even what does not happen, it is those people who are sort of totally and absolutely accountable.
Mm.
And as I say, you know, the score will take care of itself. The people who subscribe to that tend to stay. And those who don't subscribe, it's a natural selection. They also tend to leave.
Mm.
So you're then left with a culture that you have protected.
Mm.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, James. I think what really stands out for me is it is not James Moria's business.
Yeah.
It is our business.
It's our business, yeah.
Ownership minded. There you have the secret sauce.
Yeah.
Thank you for watching. My name is Pius Moshiri Mugo, the Managing Director of Nabo Capital, and you're watching Invest in Africa.
Thank you.